In 1974, nearly nobody saw Fred Hines' American-French-Swiss-British drama The Steppenwolf, based on Hermann Hesse's same name novel from 1927, which plot is in theory like the movie. The book is about Harry Haller, an alter ego of Hermann Hesse himself, who has also the same initials. Haller suffers from a torn personality. His human and his animal Steppenwolf-like side fight against each other. As a human being, he is an educated citizen with normal aspirations, interested in beautiful thoughts, music and philosophy, has money in the bank, is a supporter of bourgeois culture and able for compromises. As a wolf, he is a lonely daughter of bourgeois society and culture who considers himself a genius superior to most people, an outsider and political revolutionary. The path of healing is the reconciliation of both sides in humor. The movie was a result of the international Hermann Hesse Renaissance in the 1960s, triggered by the Steppenwolf novel. One example is the same named band, which became famous in 1968 with the Easy Rider soundtrack song Born to be Wild. Steppenwolf was not the first Hesse adaptation. He's coming after you, my friend. In 1971, George Englund's US Western musical Zachariah played in empty theaters. Zachariah and his friend set off for the Wild West to become gunslingers and join a rock band / bandit gang. They quickly outgrow the rock gang, are on their own again, gain fame, split up, and become at one point even rivals. At the end, they are friends again. The film is a very interesting interpretation of Hermann Hesse's Siddhartha from 1922. The very entertaining real insider tip with an excellent 70s rock soundtrack played at $1.2 million budget, just half of it back, and was an undeserved flop. I'm less than human in God's sight. In 1972, Konrad Rock's Siddhartha tried its luck. The West movie sticks quite faithfully to the novel, which tells the fictional story of Buddha. The real Buddha also appears as a person and is confusingly also called Siddhartha by his first name. In India, in the 6th century BC, Siddhartha and his friend set out in search for a meaningful way of life. After spiritual and worldly experiences, he finds out that the secret of life cannot be passed on from one person to another, but must be achieved through inner experience. What a twist. Usually I can't do much with religious or spiritual crap, but the story told in the book is very interesting. The movie version has nice shots, but comes off artificial and kitschy. Especially the poor dialogue delivery is a real downer. I for sure would choose Zachariah, the musical western version, over this one anytime, because from my point of view it hits in a more entertaining and creative manner still the core of the story, which at least in my understanding also suggests or even demands to get rid of dogmas and conventions. But maybe I simply have the wrong karma and haven't reached the necessary level of enlightenment yet. Who knows? Also, beyond my knowledge horizon are the budget and earnings. This goes also for the 2003 version, which was praised to Buddha. Of course, unfortunately, nowhere to find. Oh, what a pity. Must have died a thousand times. To end his mental suffering, Parihala decides to end his life on his 50th birthday. However, before that he meets Hermine, which confronts him with a normal bourgeois life, and her friend Pablo, a jazz saxophonist. Towards the end, Hala finds himself in a magic theater in which reality and illusion merge. After these confusing experiences, he realizes that he has to take life with humor. When the movie premiered, there was a kind of marketing disaster, which includes the color of the prints coming out incorrectly. For decades, the film remained little seen except for brief runs in art film houses, which is why he is till today relatively unknown. The Steppenwolf is on its own, especially for people who don't know the novel, an absolute insider tip, which is definitely worth a watch just for its unusual design. And of course, the brilliant performance of Max van Sydow, who nails the Harry Haller part. But as an adaptation of the unfilmable book, which had an influence on my life like no other, it fails. Mainly thanks to sacrificing large parts of Haller's inner life and misrepresenting characters. In the film, the sexual relationship between Haller and Hermine comes off sleazy. In the novel, she is his soulmate, who has the same problem as he does. And Maria, in the novel A Gift from Hermine, plays a much too extended part in the movie. Another annoyance is the music, which in the book includes Handel, Bach, Brahms, Wagner and Mozart, even an important character in the story. But the movie ignores his music completely, from the others almost nothing. Just a little bit Bach sound. The score, as well as the many effects, strongly reminds us of the time of creation, which unnecessarily gives the timeless story an expiration date. Hesse's book is timeless, unlike the movie, which is clearly a product of its time, namely the 1970s. The 40-minute German TV film Child Sold, which unfortunately was not available to me, is not from 1981, as he apparently wrongly dated, but from 1977 and was released on Hesse's 100th anniversary. It is based on the same named short story from 1919, in which a child unsuccessfully tries to lie to his father about something it stole from his room. In 1989, the German-Italian movie Francesco was, according to some fake encyclopedias, allegedly based on Hermann Hesse's Francis of Assisi from 1904. But in the opening credits itself, there is no mention of Hesse. Hesse's very short novel, which takes about an hour to read, is nevertheless an acceptable comparison candidate, as it begins as a chronological collection of the till then known facts about Francis of Assisi till he died, and finishes with some of the stories that were also kind of established, I guess. The movie tells pretty much the same story, but in flashbacks, and leaves out the part where he talks to birds. Female director Liliana Cavani's debut in 1966 was already a TV two-parter about Francis, which, thanks God, sadly was not available to me. What a pity. And her last movie in 2014 is also, for whatever reason, in some scenes, a one-on-one remake on the 1989 version, this time again as a TV two-parter, with less nudity and extended storyline of the Clara character to get to 3 hours, I guess. After Francis of Assisi's death in 1226, his trusted followers, the Franciscans, gather together and remember important stages of his life. Francis, the son of a rich merchant in Assisi, gets to read the Bible while a prisoner of war, and after his release, he decides to interpret the words in it literally and starts to give away all his possessions to live a life in total poverty. This, of course, is met with initial incomprehension and irritation in his environment, since till then the church was known for preaching water but drinking wine. His friends initially rejected him, but later helped him to found the Franciscan community. He gets the blessing of the church, and his movement receives an influx from all parts of Europe. Before his death, Francis gets out of nowhere wounds on hands, feet and belly, a stigmata of Christ. Hallelujah. The 2014 version goes even further with the Claire character, which followers later call themselves Clarisses, aka poor Claires, and which, like Francis, became a saint 2 years after her death. The very beautifully written book and the unnecessarily long movie about basically Jesus light are, for me as an atheist, rather involuntary funny, since it comes off like the devil is cast out with a fiend. Or in plain language, the story glorifies the splitting of one wacky sect from another wacky sect, like the Jesus story, aka New Testament, where Judaism splits into Christianity, or the Luther story, aka Reformation, where Catholics split, among others, into Protestants. But still, it was instructive to learn something about the Franciscans, who play important parts in really interesting books and movies, like The Name of the Rose. The 1996 Japanese movie Ansatsu, which unfortunately wasn't available to me, is based on Hesse's Demian from 1919, published under his pseudonym Emil Sinclair. This extremely readable supposed autobiography describes Sinclair's childhood and youth from his perspective and his successful struggle for individuality. The story also contains a radical criticism of Christian morality and dogma. In 2003, Ralf Schmerberg's so-called movie with a short and catchy title, Poem, I Set My Foot Upon the Air and It Carried Me, consists of filmed poems by 19 authors. The second is Hesse's I Know of Such from 1928, which simply shows a few scenes from the Burning Man 2000 festival in Nevada. The movie seems to be exclusively made for wannabe intellectuals and smartasses. Especially funny are some English 10 out of 10 reviews, in which heads obviously there was a completely different movie showing than the crap on the screen. As an ignorant, of course, I don't think it's even art to put this editing waste together. But it's for sure high art to sit through this garbage and stay sober. In 2012, Joe Beyer's German Austrian made for TV movie The Homecoming is based on Hesse's same named story from 1909. After 30 years, a wealthy businessman returns to his German hometown and is welcome. However, when he stands up for a widow with a bad reputation, he himself becomes an outsider and realizes that the behavior of his fellow citizens has not really changed, which is why he leaves his hometown a second time. The movie was released on the 50th anniversary of Hesse's death. He extends the interesting story, but is still faithful to the source material. In 2020, Stefan Radziwiłł's German medieval drama Narcissus and Goldmund came to the big screen. After years, Goldmund returns as an adult to Narcissus, with whom he has had a deep friendship since his youth, and tells him about his exciting adventures. Narcissus realized back then that Goldmund was not made for the monastic life and encouraged him to explore the world. The movie is based on Hesse's same-named story from 1930. There's a long part in the novel where Narcissus does not appear. It's the part after Goldmund leaves the monastery and explores the world. The movie has the same plot like the original, but unlike the book, the movie tells the story in flashbacks. He comes off like a TV production, and despite some beautiful scenes, he cannot really reproduce at any time the emotional impact of the novel.